My name is John Dansgaard Sørensen from Aalborg University, and I will give a presentation here about, or as a part of probabilistic modeling. There will be more also tomorrow. So there are three main subjects in this presentation. So the first is about the maximum likelihood method and some applications of that. The next is some Bayesian tools, especially Bayesian regression analysis. And then finally, something about how to obtain and model uncertainties. Some literature mentioned here that I'll come in during the presentation here. And yeah, we will see. So first, the maximum likelihood method that some of you probably already know. So it is one of the tools that are used to obtain the distribution parameters in a given distribution. So that's one way it's used a lot. There are other techniques to obtain distribution parameters like the moment method, B-square method, Bayesian statistics, and some of those I will also mention a little bit about later in this presentation. But first, the basic steps in using the maximum likelihood method, that is simply to obtain the likelihood function when you have some data so that they give the best fit to the parameters that you have. So you assume that you have a given distribution function and you want to fit the parameters in that distribution function. And that's also something many of you probably already have learned when you have a basic course in statistics. But there will be a small extension of that in the next slides. So just to take an example, so if you look at the Vigo distribution, which has this distribution function here, and we can obtain the density function then. So this is a pre-parameter Vigo distribution with a three parameter, so there is a scale parameter W, the shape parameter here, and a threshold gamma. And then we have this density function here, and then we simply write the likelihood function as a product here over the number of data that we assume that we have. So here is assumed that it is n. This is not easy to read from the back. Mm-hmm. But you have the slides?
Yep.
Yeah. So we have the density function here, so we simply make a product where we take the value of the density function for each of the data values that we assume that we know. And we assume they are independent. And what we do not know, that's the three distribution parameters. So the likelihood function will then be a function of those. And then we can take the logarithm of that one. Then we obtain the so-called log likelihood function. So that becomes this a little bit long expression here, which is nice because it's a summation. When we have taken the logarithm, then we get a summation and it's numerically much more stable than working with the product that we have here. So that's the main reason that that is done. And then the whole idea is when you have some data, that is to maximize this log likelihood function with respect to the three parameters that we want to obtain. So we simply want to maximize this one here, this log likelihood function. And for that you can use a lot of optimizers available on your computer from MATLAB, for example. There are also more dedicated programs that can do that, but in principle any nonlinear optimizer can do this. And then you obtain the three parameters, K, W, and tau. And then in principle you have done the fit by the maximum likelihood method. But then we can also go one step further, and that is to obtain the uncertainty related to the parameters that we have estimated. And that's very much related to the statistical uncertainty. So if we have more than 25 to 30 data, then it can be shown that asymptotically the uncertainty related to the three parameters here will be normally distributed with a mean value which corresponds to the solution that we have obtained here, and with a covariance matrix that is obtained from this expression here, namely by obtaining the so-called Hessian matrix containing the second order derivatives of the log-like good function. If that one is calculated in the point here where we have the maximum, then we obtain this H matrix here. And if you take the inverse of that and put a minus in front, then that becomes the covariance matrix of the three parameters. So that means that in the diagonal here we have the standard deviation squared corresponding to each of the three parameters that we have estimated. And outside the diagonal we then have the correlation coefficients. So that means that we have a measure of how uncertain are the parameters that we have estimated by the maximum likelihood method. And that very useful when we want to take into account that we have this uncertainty related to the parameters. And I'll give an example that shows that this can in fact have an influence on the estimates that we want to obtain. So if there are any questions, then you should just ask. So this is clear, more or less. Good, then we can use that on an example. That's one of the examples that I think it's used a lot for, a little bit related to what Jochen said just before, related to fitting data, extreme data. So here's an example where it's related to wind data, and it's used here in connection with the so-called PIGO threshold method, where we want to fit some data with a Weibull distribution. It could also be another distribution, but this is just an example. And there are usually three steps that we want to follow if you use the PIGO threshold method. Namely, first we want to identify the data that we want to use for the analysis. And that we simply do by putting a threshold and then identify the values here of the wind speed that is larger than this threshold. But in such a way that we make sure that the data that we obtain, that they are statistically independent. So if it is wind data, then it's typically done by saying that there should be at least one day between the data that we extract, such that each data represents the maximum of one storm. This could also be used for waves, wave heights. That's another set of data where this approach is used a lot. But when we then have extracted a number of data, and it's not so that we want to extract just one data per year, it could be more data per year, then we have n data, so these n largest wind speeds, and they have then been extracted from data series which cover t years. And then the next step is to fit a distribution function to these n data, and here we then fit a Weibull distribution, this three parameter Weibull distribution. And then in principle we have a model for the extreme wind speed. And this one is in this example used to estimate wind speeds with a given return period. And the example here also shows how this can be used to include the uncertainty on the parameters if we want the maximum likelihood method. So we do it with and without taking into account the statistical uncertainty. So the first step is, if you want to look at some data, to identify these data that we want to extract and then fit the distribution function by the maximum likelihood method. So this is in principle the same as we did before. We find the maximum of the log likelihood function. And then in this case, and that is something that is done quite often when using the three-parameter Weibull distribution, is that the threshold, the tau value here, is fixed. So it's not determined by the maximum likelihood. So in this case here, we only obtain two parameters, K and W. that then means that they will have a larger uncertainty in principle than if we had all three parameters included. That also then means that if you have sufficient data, more than 25 data, then we can also then obtain the statistical uncertainty, the covariance matrix, using this Hessian matrix, so that we obtain this matrix here with the standard deviations and correlation coefficients of the two parameters in the variable distribution. And that then means that we assume that K and W, they have mean values equal to the parameter that we have estimated, some standard deviations and the correlation coefficient. And then the next step would be to fit or obtain the return pair corresponding to, or the value of the wind speed corresponding to a given return pair. And that we can do first by establishing the distribution function for the annual maximum wind speed. And that we can do by taking the distribution function that we have fitted to the data and then raise that to the power of k, where this is equal to n divided by the return pair here, so the number of data per year. Again, assuming that we have independence between the data that we have selected. So the distribution function for the maximum wind speed per year then follows this distribution here, where we have this number of data per year as the exponent here. And then if we do not take into account statistical uncertainty, then we can simply obtain the return period value corresponding to a given return period by putting this distribution function we have here equal to 1 minus 1 divided by r. And that can also be simplified to 1 to take the distribution function that we have as the basic one and putting that one equal to 1 minus 1 divided by the number of data per year times the return period. And then solve that equation for the value here, which is then the return pair for the wind speed. And this can then also be extended to take into account the parameter uncertainty, because the definition of the return pair is, or can also be written in this way here, maybe as the probability that we have a stochastic variable modeling the maximum annual wind speed, and then of course the probability that the wind speed corresponding to a given return pair is larger than this value. That is the definition of the return pair value. But that can also be written in this way here, as the value that we want to obtain minus the inverse of the distribution function. And then we introduce a stochastic variable U1, which is a standard normal stochastic variable. Then we take the distribution function corresponding to that. So this is simply modeling the uncertainty related to the maximum annual wind speed. And then we have the two parameters K and W. And what we now do is that we assume that they are also uncertain, meaning that now we have here in this expression here three stochastic variables, namely U1, which is the one related to the wind speed, and then K and W related to the statistical uncertainty. And this can, so we have a probability here that we want to, or that we have defined, and then if you put that equal to this number here, which corresponds to the exceedance probability of the value that we want to obtain, then in principle we can solve this expression here for the unknown value that we have here. And I think tomorrow you will learn how to do that, or at least in principle how to do that by, for example, the reliability index technique, the first order reliability method, that can easily be used to solve this expression here, to obtain XR, defining a limit state equation that corresponds to what we have here on the left-hand side of the expression. But that is for tomorrow, and I think Jochen will say something about first order reliability measures. So you cannot do it if you have not done it before, you cannot do it today, but you will get the tools to do it tomorrow. But that means now we have integrated also the statistical uncertainty. And there is a small numerical example to illustrate that. So here there are some wind speeds selected over a period of 7 years. So that's some wind speeds that satisfy the requirement that they are from each storm during this period. And there are 38 data. They are fitted to this vibro distribution, and this is done by some software called Statrel that some of you maybe have heard about before, but that is some software and I'm not sure that we have it available here, but it's not that difficult to apply. So if you take the data and put them into that program, then there is a tool to obtain distribution parameters and fit them to data, and there you can choose to use the maximum likelihood method. And you can also choose to do that so that you also obtain the uncertainty on the parameters by solving this optimization problem. So this is simply a print of what you get out of this program called Statrel. So you obtain the three parameters in the vibro distribution, and here I have fixed one of them to 23.9 meter per second, but the two others, they are fitted. And then you also get the standard deviation of the parameters, so they are written here. And of course there is no uncertainty on the one that you have chosen yourself, because it's fixed. And you also get the correlation coefficient matrix, so the correlation coefficient. So here we only have the correlation between the two parameters W and K, and this is 0.31 in this case here.
Maybe in addition, of course this can be solved with MATLAB.
The maximum likelihood. Because that's also on one of the next slides, I think.
Okay.
In fact, and it's also in the slides that you have got, that this can also be solved by MATLAB. And as far as I remember, it can also be done by Excel. So it is not that difficult. So there is an example. You cannot read what it is here, but it is on the in the PowerPoints. So we can also solve this problem by MATLAB, because there are also a number of optimizers in MATLAB that can be used to do this. So there is a description of here how to do it in MATLAB, and you obtain exactly the same result as the one shown here. And here is then also shown a plot of the fit of the data, so with the distribution function that is fitted. The variable distribution is the red line here, and the data are shown by the blue dots that we can see here. So the fit is okay. Well, this is a typical fit. It's maybe not that good all the ways, but again, it seems okay. And then based on that and using the expressions from before, it's also possible to calculate values of the wind speed corresponding to different return pairs, 20, 50, 100 year, and they are shown here, 31, 32, and 33 meter per second, if you do not take into account the statistical uncertainty on the parameters. But if you do that and you apply, and that is what has been done here using the first order reliability method, then you obtain these values here for the wind speed corresponding to these three return pairs. And we see here that there is an increase, not that big, but there is some increase, and that is simply due to the uncertainty related to the parameters, because they do not fit completely exact, and there is also a limited number of data. So this is a way to include the uncertainty on the parameters. And that is what should be done if you make an estimate of, for example, the 50-year wind speed. You should include the uncertainty on the parameters that you have obtained from some data. And here we see that the number goes from 32.3 to 33.4. So that's a small increase.
Yes. I understand that in the second numbers, uncertainty are taken into account. But I do not understand what is the operation to pass from one number to the other.
So, what the difference is between obtaining this number and this number here?
Yeah, I understand that in the number on the right, statistical uncertainties are taken into account.
Yeah.
But I do not understand the operation to pass from one to the other.
Okay. Yeah, it was. Yeah. So, let's go back to. This slide here. So, this was the first one. So, if we do not take statistical uncertainty into account, so it's quite easy, then it's just to find the inverse of the FIFO distribution to find the value. But then the next step, that is when we want to take the statistical uncertainty into account, then we know that the parameters in the distribution function, they are also uncertain. So in fact, we have now three stochastic values, namely the wind speed itself, and then the two parameters. And this additional uncertainty, of course, will have that an effect that will have more uncertainty, and if you want to go to a certain level of exceedance, then that will have the effect that the wind speed will be larger. And the way it is done is to write simply the distribution function in the way that we normally do it, that the distribution function of the unknown value XR should be larger than or equal to 1 divided by lambda divided by the return parent. And then what is done here is simply that that is solved with using the inverse distribution function. And then we simply get into the expression here, the two parameters, which are now also stochastic values. And the problem is then to solve this probability here, because that's not one that you simply calculate, because you now have three stochastic values. And that is what can be reformulated as a limit state equation. That you tomorrow will see that we can use this first order reliability method in an efficient way to obtain or to calculate. And then this is solved iteratively with respect to this example.
Just to connect this to what I told you before, you remember, John, when you switch a little bit forward to the switchboard here?
Yes.
This is total probability theory I introduced for continuous variables.
Yeah.
And that's actually that integral here we want to solve. So this theta, these are the parameters from the FIFO distribution. That's the theta, it's a vector. Right? And that we want to integrate out, and often it's very demanding to solve this integral. Right? And therefore it can be reformulated as John did, and you can use the reliability methods we will look at tomorrow to solve this integral.
Then there is the next topic here, which is related to Bayesian statistics, Bayesian regression analysis.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I just have a question.
Yeah.
We spoke this morning about using some logic as well as observation to identify when a distribution adequately fits a parameter.
Yeah.
In terms of fitting a distribution to the to the distribution parameters of the initial distribution, that's possibly a different distribution you're using now, is that right?
So this...
So when we account for statistical uncertainty and we have, so this new distribution here, that's not necessarily...
This one?
Yeah.
This is not, this is the distribution function. Of. So that's the one that's related to the data that we have extracted from the PGO threshold technique.
Okay.
So we have a number of here, so very often we do not have a lot of years of data. So it could be, for example, if we are looking for wind turbines, then typically the number of years of data, that's maybe 5 years or 7 or something like that. And then you are asked to give an estimate of the 50-year value of the wind speed for the design of the wind turbine. And then if you just took the largest value each year, then you had 7 data, and that would not...
But actually, that was a very interesting question, because the maximum likelihood method is very nice, because it treats the uncertainty somehow consistently. uncertainties that are related to lack of observations or final data sets. But what we implicitly assume is that we know the probability distribution function to use. So when we use a probability distribution that is totally off the phenomena, then we might get a misleading result. Actually, the scatter of the parameters we get out from the maximum likelihood is not reflecting the inability of our distribution function to reflect the phenomena. So we have to be careful very much. And also, we have to be careful with a very low number of observations, because you can imagine every distribution function has an order, a degree of freedom, which is the number of parameters, right? And when we are nearby, for instance, when we have a three-parameter distribution and only have five observations, then we might get a very good fit, but it's like fitting an elephant with a polygon, right? So we have to be careful about that. So the number of observations has to be always order of magnitude higher than the degrees of freedom or parameters of the distribution. But the implicit assumption is that we know the distribution function. So we cannot, it's very hard, you know, likelihood ratio tests and things like that to test which distribution is better. But still, we can go to very misleading results when the distribution function is very much off the phenomenon.
Something that happens typically, or when you look at data for waves, is that if you look at the data then plot it like what is done here, then it's quite often possible to see that the data they are coming in fact from two distributions. Maybe because there are some depth limitations on the maximum waves that can be observed. And then you will see that there is some kind of a kink in the data. And that's then also a sign that you have selected too many data. So you have to fit to the tail. But of course, going not too far out in the tail with the data that you have. So therefore, if it is possible to get 20, 25 data, then that is absolutely to prefer. Yeah. So, Jochen, did you say anything about Bayesian statistics?
I introduced the rule of Bayes, and I also introduced the formulation for continuous variables.
Yeah. So you have mentioned a prior distribution, a posterior, and a predictive.
Uh-huh.
Good. But I have in fact put one, or I think two slides here at the end. Just to, because that is the what is being used here. So maybe you have already said that, but now
no,
I just
not in that detail.
Okay, because this is an assumption for this Bayesian regression analysis. That's the next topic, and in Bayesian statistics, there are three main concepts or words that's important to know. And you also need to know how to handle this by Bayesian statistics, which is an extension, you can say, of Bayes' rule. So this is also related to fitting data to a distribution function. So what can be assumed again here is that we have some observations, and they are also again assumed to be independent. And we have a density function that we want to fit. And that density function has some parameters, and they are here denoted by the vector q. So that could be the three parameters we had for the variable distribution before. And then the whole idea in Bayesian statistics is that we assume that we have some prior knowledge about these parameters, which we put into a density function, denoted as the prior density function for the parameters. And there is a simple one mark here just to indicate that this is the prior for the parameters. Then we have the observations. We can have n observations. And then we obtain the posterior density function, the updated density function for the parameters q. And that is the one that we have here. So there is a double mark here. And there is a vertical line here indicating that it's conditional on the data. So it's updated using the data. And that is done by this expression here, which is another way to write the base rule. And in that one we have the likelihood function, which is the same as we had before in the maximum likelihood method, but now is used in the base approach here. So we have the likelihood function here, and you will see it on the next slide. Then we multiply with the prior of the parameters, and the result we get here on the left hand side, that is then an updated density function for the parameters, given the parameters. So we simply change the order of the parameters here, or the variables, simply following the base rule. And then to make sure that this is a real density function, then we have a normalization here, where we integrate over all the values of the parameters cube. So this is the basic expression here to obtain the posterior, the updated density function for the parameters in the density function.
Maybe I should add that now theta is replaced by q, otherwise it's the same, right?
Yeah, so it's the same expression that we have here, and the likelihood function is also the same as we had before, namely the product using the density function, and we put in the data values that we know, but given the unknown, or what we consider now as uncertain parameters q. So it's the same as for the maximum likelihood method. And then it's possible to calculate this one if we know the density functions. The expression here looks complicated, but in many cases it's not that complicated. For example, for a normal distribution function where we know the standard deviation, then the expression here, if we assume this one is a normal distribution, then this one also becomes a normal distribution. And then it's also possible to go one step further and then obtain the so-called predictive density function. And that is the density function now for the stochastic variable that we are really interested in, maybe the X stochastic variable, but it's updated with respect to the data that we have used. So that's why it's written here like a conditional density function. And that is simply done by taking the density function we had from the beginning, the assumption, or the one that we want to look at, and then we multiply with the posterior density function for the parameters and integrate all values of the parameters. And then, of course, q disappear as a parameter, and we only get this density function here, which is the predictive density function. So we have a prior that we, in a way, choose ourselves based on experience or based on other data. And then we update that by data to obtain the posterior. And finally, we can obtain the predictive density function, maybe this one here. And for reliability analysis, this one here would then typically be the one to use. And the other two, that's, they are just a step in between. So this procedure here, which I put here at the end, will now be used for Bayesian regression analysis. So it's more or less exactly the same procedure, but now used for a model which we assume can be written in this way here, namely as a linear model where we have some parameters that we know. So that's the x values here, and there are some parameters beta that we consider as unknown, so that's the regression parameters, and then we have added here an uncertainty term which we assume is normally distributed with mean value equal to zero, and the standard deviation, which is written as 1 divided by the square root of h. So that means the parameters that are unknown here, that's the regression parameters beta, and it is the parameter h. And we assume that we have some observations, some data, and the data that we assume, that we know, they are then denoted by y with a hat on the top. So there are capital N of these data, And they are then connected to known values of the x parameters here. So that means that we have a whole matrix here of x values. So the values that we have here. So that is what we assume. And then one way to proceed is, again, also to write the likelihood function corresponding to the observed values that we have. So that means that now epsilon here is the stochastic variable, which is normally distributed, and that can then be applied to obtain the likelihood function, because we can write it as, again, a product over the n data sets that's available, and then we have the density function here, which is the density function related to epsilon. So in this case here, it will be a normal distribution or density function that we have to apply here. And then we can simply apply the expression here, and that can be written as y hat minus the summation here, corresponding to the regression model. So that means that we calculate this density function here for a given or conditional on a given value of the uncertain h parameter here. So that's the way to write the likelihood function in the case that we have such a regression model as this one here. And then we can again use the maximum likelihood method to obtain the best estimate of the parameters. And in connection with that, a number of parameters are calculated, and you will then see how they are applied in the next slides. So there is a matrix eta here, which is simply the matrix with the known x values transposed times itself. P is the rank of x, u is the number of observations we have minus p, and there's a v parameter here calculated using the best estimate of the parameters beta obtained by the maximum likelihood method, and that is the one that we have here in the case that we have the linear regression model. So all this is a result of using the maximum likelihood method. So now we then go one step further, and then we want to put this into a Bayesian description. So what we do now is that we consider the parameters beta and h as stochastic variables, in the same way as we had this vector q before for the parameters in a density function. And we assume that we have some prior information about beta and h, and that could be in the form of having some data, a data set that we can use to obtain prior values, and the prior values are then given in the context of these parameters that we have here. So if we had some prior data, then we can calculate these parameters here and then put a mark to indicate that that's our prior. So that is what is done here. So we can see that's the parameters from the slide before, but now with a single mark on, because that's now considered as our prior if we have some data. If we not do not have some data, but instead we have some idea about what is the mean value of beta, what is the mean value of h, and also some information about the covariance matrix of beta and the standard deviation of h, then that can also be used to formulate the prior. And that is what is indicated by these equations here. So that's an other way to obtain the prior parameters. But that is if we have such information available. So either we can have some data that we use to obtain the prior, or we can have some knowledge about basically the mean value and the standard deviation of the beta parameter and h. And then the idea is that we use that to follow the Bayesian procedure as before. And to do that, we need not only have to have these parameters, as I have mentioned here, for these four parameters here, we also need a density function for the prime. And there it's very convenient to use a so-called conjugate prior. And such a prior is one that if you use that for the prior, then the same density function will be the posterior. So these two will be the same. Then we say that they are conjugate. And it can be shown that in the case that's, or in the situation that's described here, that if we use a so-called normal gamma distribution, which is the one that is shown here, if that one is used as the prior, then it also becomes the posterior. So it is a combination of a normal distribution function and a gamma distribution function, or in fact an inverse gamma distribution function. This is not something that's easy to do by hand, but the computer can do this, and there are programs where this is put into already programs, so you do not need to do that yourself. But if this is chosen as the prior with these parameters that we had before, and then we assume that we have some new data that we can use to update our prior, and now we know that this density function here also becomes the posterior, then the only thing we have to do is to obtain the updated values of the parameters. And they can be obtained by these four expressions that are shown here. So eta with a double mark is then the parameter in the posterior. So that is simply obtained as the prior plus eta corresponding to the data. And then there are some a little bit complicated equations here that I will not go into the details with, but you can see them. And they can be calculated if you have the data and you have the prior, and then you obtain the posterior. And that one will then be this normal gamma distribution, which is a combination of a normal distribution function and a gamma 2 distribution. So then, by that, we have an updated distribution function for the parameters for beta and h. But also here we can obtain a predictive distribution function, so that means an updated distribution function for the response. So if we go back, then the response, that is what we have here on the left hand side, so we can also obtain an updated predictive density function for this one, for this parameter. And that, let me see, that one becomes a student t distribution as seen here. So this is the updated density function for the response given the data, and that can be written by this long expression here, but that is a student t distribution with a parameter here, an additional parameter that is needed. So it follows more or less exactly the same principles as before, but the equations just become much more complicated. So that is what can be done by such a regression analysis. And here it should be noted, as I write here, that if the standard deviation, so that means this h is assumed to be known, then much of this simplifies, and then it simplifies into normal distribution functions. So then things become much more simple. But it's not always that we know this h parameter. This is typically the difficult one to obtain. So in many cases, it's considered as being uncertain, and you also want to update that one. But if it is known, then all these expressions become more simple. And in fact, those expressions, they are in the book by Michael Faber. So if you look in the pages related to this regression model, then you will find those expressions given there. But what I have shown here is then the extension where we have that the h parameter is also considered as uncertain. Yes? Questions to this? There are a few simple examples here to illustrate that it can be used in fact also in more practical applications. The first slide here is just an example without any data, but in fact this can be used if you want to fit some fatigue data. So if we have the SN curve connecting the number of cycles to failure with a given stress range, S and N is the number of data cycles to failure, and we have the two parameters K and M, which are unknown, if we want to do some statistics related to those, then that can be formulated also as a linear regression model, simply by taking LN to this expression here, then we have the relation here. And here we can consider the two unknown parameters, LNK and M, as the two beta 1 and beta 2 parameters in a linear regression model. And data, the X vector, or that corresponding to that one, will then be, so here we have X1 and X2 related to those, so that will be 1 and it will be LNS, so LN to the stress planes. And then what we will typically have available, that's number of cycles to failure N, and it is the stress range connected to that. So that means that we know the X values here, and we know the result on the left-hand side. And then we can simply do statistics as shown in the previous slides. So that's one way to apply it. And there is another example, not on this slide here, but on the next slides. This slide here and the following one is just another example, which is much simpler, but just also to illustrate the steps into the Bayesian approach, but here applied to only one stochastic variable, namely the yield strings. And this is an example taken from the book here, so you can also follow that. And what is shown here in the red box, that is simply the equations I just showed before. They are not on the slides. I put them a little bit later after I made the PDF version. But it's the same as you saw before. And you can also get a copy of these slides. So what is written here is that this is the prior, this is the posterior, and this is the predicted density. And that is of course what we can obtain here. So what is assumed here is that we only consider the mean value to be unknown, and assuming that the yield strength here can be modeled by a normal distribution function with a mean value and with a standard deviation. And the standard deviation we assume to be known equal to 17.5 megapascal. So only the mean value is unknown here, and that has a prior here with a mean value of 350. And the standard deviation that is 10. So the mean value here in the stochastic variable for the yield strength is then also in itself uncertain, able to apply. And then we have some data. Here we have 5 data. And then we can simply follow a similar procedure and then obtain the posterior for the mean value. And that becomes this one here. And the mean value goes a little bit up compared to the prior, and the standard deviation goes down. And that is what is illustrated in the figure shown here, because here we have the prior, so that is the full line here. And then what is also shown is the posterior, so that's the dashed line here. And we can see the mean value is a little bit larger and the standard deviation is smaller, because it's more narrow. And what is also shown is the likelihood function, so that's the one that we also have here. But basically what we are interested in or to show here is that we have a prior and a posterior for the mean value. And then we can then go one step further and obtain the predictive distribution function for the yield strengths. And that is the one that is shown here together with the one that we started with, the original one. But the updated one, the predictive one, is the dashed one here. A little bit to the right, indicating that the mean value has increased a little bit by the data. And then the next example here is a little bit the same, but now extended to regression model, and here it's related to some data for timber, also taken from the book of Michael Paper, so it's also written there, but it's applying the same principles as I showed before, but assuming here that the mean value, no, that the H parameter, the standard deviation is known. So in that way the expression becomes not so complicated. But what we have here is that we have the tensile strength of the timber, denoted by X, and we have the modulus of elasticity, which is denoted by Y. And then there is a linear regression model here saying that the modulus of elasticity is linear in the tensile strength, but with two parameters, beta 0 and beta 1, and we have some uncertainty, which is assumed to be normal distributed with mean value 0 and an unknown or a standard deviation that we want to obtain. And what is assumed is that we have some data, and they are shown here. And then we could have used the maximum likelihood method to obtain a first guess of beta and beta 1 and this standard deviation here. But that is not what is done in the book. There, instead, the least square method is used to obtain these parameters. So that's an alternative way to do it. In this case here, the difference would be, I think, it would result in the same values. It's just another way to obtain the parameters. So here the parameters beta 0 and beta 1, they are obtained by the least square technique. We obtain these two numbers here, and the standard deviation, which is this one here. And the corresponding covariance matrix, that is the one shown also here. And then there is a Bayesian updating, assuming that there are some additional information available, namely two more data sets, as shown here. And then assuming that the standard deviation is known, we can consider what we had here as the prior for the two parameters beta 1 and beta 0 and beta 1, and then we can obtain a posterior using the data that's available, and then we obtain the two values here for beta. So there is a double mark here, whereas the single mark here indicated that that was the prior with the corresponding covariance matrix here. But here we then obtain the posterior, and I have not shown the equations here, but they are similar to those I showed before, but a little bit more simple, because we do not here assume that this standard deviation is unknown. But that then means that having these posterior parameters, we can write an updated regression line simply by using these two parameters. And that is then also what is shown here. So we have a prior based on four data points. I think that's those shown here. And there is one more somewhere. And they are then updated with the new results, namely this one here and this one here. And then we get the posterior, which is this line here. Yeah. So that was some aspect of linear regression analysis. So now we move to something different, or not completely different, but something related to model uncertainties. So now I also think that Jochen has said something about different types of uncertainty that we need to consider if we need to make a proper model to be used for decision analysis tomorrow and the day after tomorrow. So we have different types of uncertainty, and I'll just repeat it here. So we can have some physical uncertainty, so that would be the yield strength, or it can be the annual maximum wind speed. So that's some uncertainties that they will be there, and they are not that easy to change. So they are denoted as physical uncertainties or aleatory uncertainties. But then we can have some other uncertainties that we also need to account for. And that can be measurement uncertainty. So if we have measurements, then we have some uncertainty related to that. We can have statistical uncertainty due to a limited number of observations or data. But if we had a lot of data, then that uncertainty here would disappear. And the same with the measurement uncertainty, if we had very precise instruments, then that could also disappear. So it's something we can control. But we can also have model uncertainty, because typically we put up a model for parameters that we want to obtain a mathematical expression. For example, if we want to model the load bearing capacity of a column with respect to stability, then we put up a model that can say something about that, but that model will have some uncertainty, and that is model uncertainty. And that is very important to model. And of course, the model uncertainty is connected exactly to that model that we consider. So this next slides here, they are related how to obtain this model uncertainty. And if we had a very perfect model, then the model uncertainty would also disappear. But then that could be very impractical to use, very complicated to use. So sometimes we choose a more simple model, but then we'll have some more uncertainty related to that. So that's a balance. And these uncertainties here, they are also called epistemic uncertainties, because we, in a way, can control them ourselves. If we do something better, then we can reduce them. And there are different ways to formulate and to make these models more and more complicated. So what I'll show here is in the relatively simple end of how to obtain model uncertainties. This can also be done much more complicated, but I don't think there is a need to do that as a starting point. So we will assume that we have a model, and this is here denoted by F, and it will, in this first expression, our model here, be a function of some parameters x that we consider as a physical uncertainties. So that could be the yield strength of steam, for example, if it is the buffling capacity of a steam column we are looking at, then that would be one of the parameters that would go in. So there will be some parameters here that we will denote as physical uncertainties, denoted here by x. And then there can be some other parameters, beta, which are regression parameters, someone that we want to fit in the mathematical model, F here. And then one way to model uncertainty is simply to multiply this expression here with a stochastic variable. Another possibility could be to add an uncertainty, a model uncertainty. And then there could be even further possibilities. But what is very often done, at least when looking at what is done for in structural engineering, that is to multiply with a stochastic variable here. And that model uncertainty is the one here in the middle, denoted by delta, which is the model uncertainty, which is very often assumed to be log normal with a mean value of 1 and a standard deviation. And then there is also a factor B here, which is the bias of the model. So that's also a parameter that is unknown and connected to the model uncertainty. So what is unknown, that is in principle the parameters beta here. They can then in some cases be known, but it is at least the bias B and it is the standard deviation here in the model uncertainty. And then we can simply use, again, the maximum likelihood method to obtain these parameters. So that's one possibility. So what we assume is that we have some data available. So we assume that we know the values of x, so the physical uncertainties. So we assume that if we do a test, then we measure these parameters. And then, of course, we also, so we measure this value, those values here. And we, of course, also measure the result on the left-hand side. They are known. But it is very important to realize that we need to know the values of these physical uncertainties. And this is important because in the end, we would typically use this as part of a reliability analysis or as part of a larger model where we want to account for the different uncertainties. So what we want to account for in this wider application of this, this is the uncertainty in the X vector here, the physical uncertainties. But then we also want to account for the model uncertainties, so the two different types of uncertainty. And in addition, we will typically also be interested in accounting for the statistical uncertainty, so due to the limited number of data, and if measurement uncertainties, then also these uncertainties. But what is in focus here, that is in fact to set up a model where we can include the physical uncertainty and then estimate the model uncertainty here. And that can be done by the maximum likelihood method because the unknown parameters, they are clear. So that's one possibility. And there is another possibility that at least if you want to use the Eurocodes is an approach that is used a lot, namely an approach which is described in Eurocode 0. So I have also included a few slides on that one because that's used, I think, a lot, at least for some materials, to obtain the bias here and this model uncertainty here in a systematic way, which can be used also for reliability analysis and as part of setting up decision problems. But if we, as the first step, use the maximum likelihood method, then the procedure is exactly the same as in the previous applications of the maximum likelihood method, namely that we identify the unknown parameters, so that would be beta here, the bias B, and the standard deviation of the model uncertainty. And then we formulate the likelihood function corresponding to those. So that would simply be a product here over all the data sets available, where we use that we have assumed that the model uncertainty is log norm distributed. So this will be the density function for the log norm distribution for the model uncertainty. And then what is included here is simply the expression for the model, and then conditional on the parameters. And we can then formulate the log likelihood function, and we can maximize that, and in that way obtain the unknown parameters. And in addition, we can also include statistical or parameter uncertainty on these if we have sufficient number of data by obtaining this matrix that I had before, so that they can also be included. And then in principle we are done, because then we have what we want to have. The other approach, which is to some extent the same, but not exactly, is to use the approach in Eurocode 0 in NXD. And I think this is quite a good procedure that can easily be used for many different sets of data. And it is very useful as a first step to obtain input to reliability analysis. So first, there is a figure here illustrating also what we want to do, namely a figure that shows the values of the model on the one axis and the experimental obtained data on the other axis. So we know from the measurements, then we know all the values of the stochastic variables here, the X vector, the physical uncertainties, they are measured. And then what we can do is that we can simply plot all the data sets that have been obtained by the experiments, and that's the dots that are shown here. And if the model was perfect, then all the dots here would be on a straight line with a slope of 1. So that if the data was perfect, but that's not the case typically. So there will be a bias, meaning that the slope will not be 1 here, and we'll have some scatter, and the scatter is measured by the standard deviation of the model uncertainty, or equivalently, the coefficient of variation of the model uncertainty. So that is what the next two slides there are about. That's the steps to be followed according to this NXD to obtain B here and this coefficient of A is not the bottle uncertainty. This is maybe not so easy to read, but to have the copies of it so we can see how it looks like. So we simply have the data available, and we have also the corresponding values obtained from the model. And then the first step is to obtain the parameter B based on a linear regression analysis. And then there are some steps here that can be followed to obtain the coefficient of variation of the model uncertainty. And there are some steps here where we take ln because model uncertainty here is assumed to be log norm distributed. So it is in fact mean value and standard deviation of ln to the test data that are calculated. But the end result is that as what we see here at the last or the expression here, that we obtain the coefficient of variation of the model uncertainty. And here we have the bias. And then what is also in some situations done, at least in this NXD in the Eurocodes, is that the model that we are looking at that's linearized in the mean values, and then you can calculate also the contribution to the total uncertainty from the physical uncertainties based on this linearized model. So first you can obtain the mean value and you can also obtain the coefficient of variation of that one, meaning that then we can also obtain the total coefficient of variation of the model, which will then have two contributions, one from the model uncertainty and one from the uncertainty in the x vector in the physical parameters, but their importance in the model that we are looking at. And that's the one that's obtained here based on the linearization of the model. And we can also add measurement uncertainty if needed. But this is a simplified way to represent the uncertainties. And there are two examples here, which are from some data that I have been looking at some point in time. So there is an example here where these data, they are plotted. So this is an example where there is a small uncertainty and also a bias that is not that very big. It's 1.06 and the coefficient of variation is 12%, but that is still something. But it's much less uncertainty than what is obtained in the other example here, where there is a large bias, 2.5, indicating that the model is quite conservative. But on the other hand, the model is quite uncertain because the coefficient of variation is 25%. So these data, they have been obtained from some concrete walls where the load bearing capacity has been obtained and compared to a model. And those models, they have typically the uncertainty that is shown here. Then, of course, you need to account for both that you have quite a large bias, but on the other hand, a very big scatter. But the procedure in the Eurocodes here is quite nice to follow, and you get these two numbers here that you need if you want to go further in reliability analysis. And tomorrow I'll show some other numbers for model uncertainties that are those typically used for reliability analysis and for code calibrations and similar approaches. But it is very important to model these model uncertainties because they are in many cases of the same order as the physical uncertainties themselves, or even larger. And sometimes we just guess that the model uncertainty is will have a coefficient of variation of 10%. But we have a feeling, but we don't know. But if it is at all possible, then we should have some test data to use as basis for quantifying these model uncertainties.
This red line came from the maximum likely destination, yes?
Yeah.
To compare it, the red line is you obtained from those, and then you had estimated a model for that, and you compare it with the which is based on your code, yes?
Yeah, so the dashed red line here is the one obtained from the data.
Okay.
Yeah, so that could be done by the maximum likelihood method, but also by the least squares technique.
Okay.
That would
but
be almost the same.
What was your interpretation of the this one?
Of this one?
Yeah.
Yeah, here we can see that the model is quite conservative compared to the test data. So we obtain much larger load gain capacities than what the model predicts. So that's why the bias is quite large. But on the other hand, the uncertainty of the model is also very large. So in a way you need to account for that, and that is typically done by these models that then they choose conservative parameters. So that was what I had. And then there is something that you can read. There is also a small exercise or example that you can look at if you want to estimate these model uncertainties. So there are some data in an Excel file that I think Sebastian can distribute. And then you can try to apply this procedure here.